Can everyone hear me okay? So I changed a little bit my talk last night just to take into account some extra things that I hadn't considered before. So I apologize that some of these slides may not correlate exactly to what comes out of my mouth. How is blockchain changing the market? So the market that I'm talking about is the capital markets. So BlockEx, just to give you a very short background, because I'll come on to more of what we're working on at the end. We've been building blockchain solutions within the capital market space for the last 3 years now. I've been working with blockchain for coming up to 6 years. So we've seen a lot come and go, and the market change from being very resistive to, you know, actually this stuff starting to take hold now. We're moving from proof of concept through to production, and this is, you know, something that benefits the industry as a whole. So I guess I don't need to dwell on this. You know, blockchains, distributed ledgers, and the four sort of things that, from a financial markets perspective, that are really key to keep in mind are security, transparency, trust, and the fact that, you know, we can have a layer that takes care of all of these transactions with the characteristics of everything is. So we've got a secure way of recording information between parties, and that's kind of where, you know, the low-hanging fruit exists within the capital markets. You'll hear me refer to digital assets. So we consider digital assets in our context to be any traditional financial asset or instrument that's built using blockchain technology. So, you know, simply not creating anything new or exotic specifically, but innovating the way that assets are created, assets are tracked, and assets are controlled within the ecosystem. So some of the potential use cases that we've looked at and considered over the last 3 years are as follows. ETFs, exchange-traded funds. So blockchain provides a very interesting layer for packaging up baskets of things in a very transparent way, and of course enabling the trade of them. Debt issuance and trade finance. This is something that we have done a lot of work on over the last year particularly, and this is what we've been working on with the support of BigchainDB, and I'll come on to explain more about our bond platform a little later. But debts and trade finance, they're things that have, one instrument has many, many outputs. And this is somewhere where something where automation provides a huge amount of benefit, where you have lots of counterparties involved and lots of pieces of information that need distribution, and it's a very event-driven process. Equities, fairly self-explanatory. ICOs, we are also doing a lot in the ICO space at the moment, leveraging the power of all the other automation technology that we put in place for KYC, AML, you know, PEPs and sanctions checking. There's also growing interest in government-issued digital currencies within the capital market space. Estonia has obviously been very prominent in this recently, and there's been much complaint in the European Parliament about them wanting to do so. The reinsurance and insurance markets, again, things that are very complicated to track from a granular perspective. We can use blockchain systems really to empower the transparency of the information flow. And within reinsurance, that's of particular interest because what happens is when an underwriter takes on risk, they resell the risk, and they resell the risk, and they resell the risk, and it keeps going and going and going and going. And this is an industry that's really not very modernized. In fact, much of this trading still takes place on paper, on the trading floor at Lloyd's. So when something terrible does happen, it's really, really hard sometimes to very quickly identify who holds the risk and therefore who has to pay out. So you know, this is something that's quite transformative. And again, within the commodities space, and I include within commodities things like you know, other kinds of hard goods like art and property, you know, things that are physical. A lot of interesting work being done to tokenize these sorts of things to simply track ownership. So the primary benefits then. security, I don't think I need to dwell on this particularly, you know, apart from to say that, you know, the cryptography that secures the blockchain, you know, allows us to be fairly certain about the actions that have occurred, and also to provide infrastructure that many people can interact with without having to have, you know, the necessary burdens of old school walled gardens and, you know, VPN point-to-point connections and secured infrastructure. We can enable participants to connect to systems within the capital markets in a much more fluid way. This is the core of really what provides the tangible interest and benefit within institutions right now, which is speed of settlement. We're working with a number of large institutions, the largest of which will be announced at Cybos in a couple of weeks' time, on methods to use blockchain to trade and exchange assets between participants, so to bridge from the existing clearing systems onto a blockchain ledger. You know, within the old world, you have, you know, T plus one, T plus two, T plus three settlements. So, you know, everything happens post the event. And this creates a number of problems. The first is counterparty risk, that because people don't actually have to have the goods in place before they go ahead with the transaction, people can do things like naked short selling and, you know, other market sort of unfriendly activities which have previously occurred. With blockchain, we can know where the assets are beforehand, and when the trade executes, we can very quickly settle afterwards. It's worth saying at this stage that, you know, from my perspective, from the trading side, it's very difficult to do trading on a blockchain because any distributed system introduces latency and trading tends to have to occur very quickly. There are ways around this, like short-term periodic auctions and things like that, but the market's not in that position right now. So from our perspective, we look at using blockchain in a pre- and post-trade perspective rather than for the trade itself. But the bottom line is counterparty risk is made extremely negligible by having blockchain on both sides of the trade, which is pretty cool and also highly disruptive because there are so many intermediaries in the space who rely on that long process of settlement to basically have funds floating and, you know, cover 24-hour exposures, and they make very healthy money, and they're not going to do that anymore. Regulation. The main product that we've been working on that comes under the regulatory umbrella is our bond issuance platform. We've been in the FCA sandbox now for best part of coming up for 4 months, and we've been working with them to go through the process of getting the authorizations that we need to be able to deliver our bond issuance platform out into the wider world. So authorizations for arranging, safeguarding of client funds, client money, and those sorts of things. What we've been doing with bonds is not fundamentally changing anything about the way that bonds are issued in terms of the paperwork, but it's been to do with compressing the life cycle so we can do within 24 to 48 hours what used to take 3 weeks at a fraction of the cost, slashing about 75% of the cost off of bond issuance. So just to quickly cover the other things that we do, because I'm conscious we're coming short on time. At BlockEx, at its core, we have an exchange platform, and then we have a digital asset creation tool that sits on top of that, and that tool will allow you to create bonds, loans. We have a templating engine, digital identity service that sits within that to allow documents to be created and contracts to be signed between counterparties. And so essentially we can manage the entire life cycle of digital assets from origination, issuance, exchange, settlement and redemption. And we've also applied all of this sort of compliance technology as well, most recently into creating an ICO platform on the back of this, because we already have a cryptocurrency exchange to help companies that are coming through and raising money through ICOs to use all of the compliance tech that we built to participate in regulated markets to try and clean up a little bit the activity of what's going on to put ICOs into a space where regulators feel more happy about it. So I'm sorry that that was quite a quick whistle-stop tour, but I'd be happy to take some questions.
So we have time for one or two questions from the audience. I see one here.
Thank you, Alex, for the presentation. I have a technical question about the tokens.
Yep.
There are unique tokens on your own blockchain, or they are Ethereum tokens that I can sell outside your platform?
Within the context of which product? The bond platform? Or
yeah, so you tokenize securities.
Yeah, right? within the bond platform, we use a private deployment of BigchainDB underneath. And that is designed in such a way that it can be federated. So if we want to bring other participants in, we can include them within the infrastructure. But right now, we run that infrastructure entirely internally. With regards to the platform more broadly, we're protocol agnostic, so we can support and indeed do support a wide variety of blockchain frameworks, including all of the obvious large public ones as well.
Thank you.
Thank you. Maybe we take one more?
Sure.
A question regarding competition, because with your project, you are kind of a little bit in competition with the traditional players who are doing their own blockchain efforts with R3 or even in-house. How do you experience that?
There is competition, and that's why we have sort of pushed quite hard to work with strategic partners. So we're working with a European clearinghouse on a tokenization project for existing securities, and we are also in advanced stage of discussions with a couple of major international stock exchanges, both in North America and Europe, and we're also doing a lot of consulting services into banks as well. So we've tried to set ourselves up so that we can work with incumbents and work with institutions because, you know, obviously they do pose an existential threat if they turn against you. But more importantly than that, actually, they already have all of the customers. And to go through a business development effort of taking customers from existing market incumbents is incredibly expensive. And, you know, we'd need to raise hundreds of millions in order to put ourselves in a position to do that. So, you know, as opposed to trying to disintermediate and disrupt, we're trying to help people to innovate and change their business models, you know, from an existing market perspective.
Is there a follow-up question? Or?
Yeah, go on.
Just a follow-up question on that from the regulators' side. How do you experience the collaboration with regulatory authorities or with the ECB? Because, for example, they spend billions on building this settlement platform called T2S that can be obsolete with blockchain. And I could imagine that they're not particularly happy of scrapping their whole investment in favor of something completely new shortly after it was just implemented.
I would imagine you're right that they won't be in favor of scrapping it. Our experience with regulators has been primarily with the FCA in the UK, with the Innovation Hub there, and I have to say, they have been extremely helpful to us, and they've been very focused on making sure that we can get ourselves out to market. So they haven't been an encumbrance at all. We're about to go into discussions in with one of the European regulators about the other product, and we'll see what comes of that. But yeah, T2S has been mentioned in our discussions with the European clearer. As a potential obstacle to overcome, but that's the realities of life. You know, if you take 10 years to build a system, it's going to be obsolete by the time you launch it. So,
with those wise words, Aleksander, thank you.
Thanks.